The air we breathe, the water we drink, and the contaminants we're exposed to all have profound impacts on our health. In fact, the World Health Organization estimates that about 1/4 of our global disease burden is attributed to modifiable environmental factors like pollution. Children, pregnant women, and other vulnerable or underserved populations face the highest environmental risk to their health. Researchers at the Nicholas School are working with colleagues in medicine, engineering, public policy, and other disciplines at Duke to develop new approaches and technologies to identify the pathways of exposure and find ways to reduce the risk. Whether it's testing for toxins in common household products, developing tools to track water contamination to its source, or identifying more effective approaches for malaria control, we're working to protect human health and the health of the ecosystems we call home.
I'm Heather Stapleton. I'm an environmental chemist and exposure scientist. My research program focuses on identifying man-made chemicals in consumer products and construction materials that are often applied to the indoor environment. And understanding where they're used and how they're used is often very challenging in the field of environmental health and environmental science. We're really interested in understanding and connecting the dots between chemicals and products, exposure among the general population, and whether there are or are not any health risks from that exposure. We're one of the few labs in the country that have the capacity to measure or detect a large suite of different flame retardant chemicals used in consumer products and construction materials. We've been conducting research in this field for more than 10 years now, and from our previous research, we do know that children have a disproportionate amount of the exposure compared to adults for specific classes of flame retardants. Research has suggested that exposure to flame retardants, and in particular PBDEs, is associated with deficits in neural development, particularly in children, which translates to deficits in cognitive function, IQ, sometimes associated with hyperactivity. It's also been associated with alterations in circulating levels of thyroid hormones. Recently, our research group collaborated with doctors in the Duke Cancer Center to examine exposures to flame retardants in individuals recently diagnosed with papillary thyroid cancer and compared their exposures to individuals that were cancer-free but of similar demographics. And we found that exposure to several flame retardant chemicals was significantly higher in the individuals that were diagnosed with papillary thyroid cancer. Identifying what these chemicals are in these consumer products can be very challenging for the general public because they're not disclosed on the product or the labeling. Therefore, we've considered our laboratory to be almost an environmental CSI. We bring products into the lab, analyze them by mass spectrometry to identify the chemical structures. So now if there are individuals in the general public that are concerned about these chemicals and want to understand or determine if these chemicals might be present in the product in their home, they can actually take a small piece of it and actually mail it to us, and we can analyze it free of charge and report back to them on whether these chemicals were present or absent. One of the things I am most proud of is the research we conducted on flame retardant chemicals in baby products. A government agency, in this case the state of California, used that data to exempt several baby products, including nursing pillows, baby carriers, baby strollers, so that manufacturers no longer have to use those chemicals in those products, which does lead to reductions in exposure.
My name is Randy Cramer. I'm an environmental economist. In the early days, I was doing studies of how land use was affecting environmental quality, but I quickly learned that it was also affecting human health in the communities surrounding the areas where we were studying. Worldwide, over 200 million cases of malaria occur every year, and this results in about 500,000 deaths. The environment can have a significant impact on malaria transmission in several ways. First, when there's land use change, that can alter the habitat for mosquitoes, which transmit malaria. Secondly, if there are major dam construction projects that alter the flow of water, that can increase malaria transmission in surrounding communities. And thirdly, climate change can play a role. So when temperatures rise, malaria can move to higher elevations or can move back into areas where it was previously eradicated. The scale-up of malaria interventions worldwide has had a major impact on reducing deaths from malaria. But there's concern that some of these interventions are losing their effectiveness. We've worked with colleagues in Tanzania to build an interdisciplinary research team to look at how better to deliver malaria control in rural villages. And this work has involved household surveys, collection of blood samples, collection of mosquitoes, also geospatial mapping. And this has allowed us to look at the effectiveness of different malaria control strategies in multiple study sites. One of the things that we've put a lot of emphasis on is the use of bacteria-based larvicide called BTI that we have found kills mosquito larvae in an environmentally safe way and in a cost-effective way. In addition, we've worked with colleagues to develop what we call the Malaria Decision Analysis Support Tool, or MDAS. The tool produces a number of simulations that allow decision makers to look at the trade-offs in terms of health, environment, and economic cost for applying different approaches to malaria control. One advantage of using the MDAS decision tool was that we were able to bring together people from multi-sectors who were working on malaria but not necessarily working together. And we find that the tool creates dialogue that otherwise would not occur. There are a couple of things that I've really enjoyed about this work. One is learning from my African colleagues because they know far more about controlling malaria than we do, but we've been able to bring in some additional resources and research approaches. I'm very excited about a new project in Madagascar working with my Duke colleague, Charlie Nunn, to look at how deforestation and biodiversity loss is affecting the transmission of diseases from small mammals to humans. And we're particularly fortunate that we're able to work with the conservation team of the Duke Lemur Center, which has an office in the region. In order to carry out the work, we're taking a group of students to Madagascar who are helping us collect socioeconomic data, ecological data, and health data, which will form the basis of a larger study. And we're particularly interested in how farmer decision-making around a national park is influencing this disease transmission. The goal is to develop programs that will improve the sustainability of farming practices as well as to reduce disease risk. We've been able to move forward a research agenda in ways that none of us would have been able to do individually. It's also been a wonderful opportunity to train students, both U.S. students and African students, who are working together side by side in the field.
My name is Avner Vengosh. I'm a geochemist. I work on water, and I study water contamination in different parts of the world. We work on different areas and trying to understand what is the source of water contamination, why water are being contaminated, and how it affects human health. We currently work on India, in China. Previously, we worked in Morocco, Jordan, in the United States, and in North Carolina. We use a wide range of geochemical and isotopic tools that we have developed here at Duke. We can tell whether these contaminants are naturally occurring, whether they're coming from coal ash, whether they're coming from oil and gas operation. So we build these very sensitive methods, and I think that's make us a bit different from the rest of the world. We've been studying coal ash since the Tennessee Valley Authority, the TVA coal ash spill that took place in Kingston in 2009. We looked and we conducted several field work and several leaching experiments in the lab, and we characterized the chemistry and the isotope ratios of coal ash, basically building kind of a fingerprint. What in coal ash and how you identify it once you have contamination. And what's in coal ash? Everything. We have arsenic, radioactivity, selenium, boron, a long list of elements that are extremely toxic, and some of them are carcinogenic. We investigated 15 sites all over the southeast of the US, and we found that all of them are leaking, and shallow groundwater and surface water adjacent to those sites are already contaminated. We are investigating what is the impact of fossil fuel extraction on water resources. Ironically, we found that those fracking chemicals that people are so afraid from hydraulic fracturing, most of them will be retained and remain with the shale. And the water coming out is actually saline water. But it does contain other level of contaminants. Once the chemistry of the wastewater mixed with the river, once you take this blend and treat it, which you do in any drinking water utilities, you would generate another type of chemical called disinfection byproduct, which is extremely toxic, which go directly into your drinking water source. And we found that even a tiny amount of wastewater, less than 1%, being added into the water could induce the formation of those disinfection byproducts in a treated water. That is a potential health risk to those living all over in the watershed of oil and gas operation. The public and the utilities are ready to listen, and they're ready to work with the science to do their operation in a way that will have minimized the environmental effect. The problem is here and now, how you minimize the environmental effect. And that's where we are.
Today, here at the Nicholas School, we are a community of scholars and learners focused on understanding the complex ways human actions change our environment and how these changes, in turn, can affect our own health as well. Our strength is our ability to work together on that arc that leads from discoveries to solutions.